Good afternoon, and welcome to the NASA Tweetup at NASA headquarters in Washington, D.C. Thank you all for joining us today. We have a great crowd here of space tweeps here to meet astronaut Doug Wheelock, known as @astro_wheels on Twitter. And Doug Wheelock was on the space station for 163 days last year. I'm sure at times it probably felt like years to him. He was a member of the Expedition 24 and 25 crews. He launched in a Soyuz on June 15th and returned on Thanksgiving Day, 2010. And while he was in space on July 31st, there was an ammonia pump failure. Many of you may have seen that. And he and his crew members had to respond to that pump failure and performed 3 unplanned spacewalks. They spent 22 hours spacewalking to repair that, actually replace the pump and get the space station back in good configuration. He also was the commander of Expedition 25 and assumed command on September 22nd. While he was on space, he and his crewmates did a number of experiments on the space station and supported a number of experiments, and he can tell you all about that. We're very lucky to have him here, and he's going to show a video and talk a little bit about his experience on the space station, and then we'll have a lot of time for questions and answers. Now, of course, the reason you all are here probably is because you probably followed him on Twitter and saw all the wonderful photos he took from the space station and sent down to us. Some of you may know that he was also the first person to check in space. He checked into the International Space Station on Foursquare on October 22nd, and that launched a partnership between NASA and Foursquare, and he is wearing a special Foursquare badge for us today during the tweet up. So please welcome Doug Wheelock.
Good trip. Hey, guys. Good to see you, sir. Thank you, Stephanie. Oh, it's great to see everybody. Thank you. 163 years. It seemed like that. It's great to spend some time with you. I actually just came from Walter Reed, which was an incredible experience. I'm kind of coming down from that high to talking to some of our wounded soldiers over there and Marines, and so that was an incredible experience. So I'm kind of trying to wind up. No speech today, okay? So no speech, and I think this might be the first event you've ever been at where tweeting is encouraged, and photographs and. I think if you have something that makes noise, that's probably okay as well. And I do have my Foursquare patch here. It's not quite sewn on yet. And here I've been telling everybody that I was the first mayor of, I said the mayor of space, but then that we went, I got back and was cleared to do our post-flight appearances. And the first place that I was invited to was to Las Vegas, and I went with Stephanie, and it was a sort of a social media convention for folks that work in the PR and marketing and various businesses and things, sort of nationally and actually internationally as well. And I found out there, I was so disappointed, I found out there that you actually have to check in twice to become the mayor. So I've been telling everybody that I was the mayor of space, and it's like, not so fast. So I emailed Scott Kelly on orbit. He's the gentleman that actually just returned less than 12 hours ago from the space station. He had taken over command of the space station after I left. And I sent him an email, said, man, you better check in twice if you want to be considered as, if you want to put mayor on your resume when you get back home. So it's great to be here. This is a lot of fun. We're going to try to be very, very informal. I did want to show you some video here in just a minute, but I wanted to tell you a little bit about our mission and actually my experience with tweeting, because who kind of went into this tweeting world kicking and screaming? I mean, anybody? Okay, I was the same. You know, about a year ago, I didn't even have a Twitter account, and I was highly encouraged by NASA to keep up actually some good work that had been started on the space station by T.J. Creamer and also Suichi Noguchi, who has a tremendous amount of followers, and to start this tweeting, continue this tweeting from space. And I was going to bridge the gap to the next crew that was coming up, and I politely declined because I thought, you know, I investigated a little bit, and what I understand now is the power of this type of media. But I looked at it as I looked at those 140 characters, you know, and I thought, man, first of all, I don't know if I could be that brief, you know. And to me, it was sort of like a soundbite, you know. And I thought, you know, this experience, I've trained so long and so hard for this experience. And I knew that what I was going to see out those windows was going to be very profound and life-changing. And then especially going outside to do these spacewalks. We originally had one scheduled, planned. Tracy and I were going to go outside. And we scrapped that one, and we actually ended up doing three sort of emergency contingency spacewalks. And the rest is history, but we spent a lot of time outside. And I knew that I wanted to be just a little bit deeper than the soundbite, you know? And what I wasn't realizing and picking up on is what you guys all know is the power and the transformation of this tweet once it hits the internet. And it's what happens after you tweet. That's the real power in this type of media, I think. And it's, you know, it's obviously a great way to kind of keep track of each other and where you're going, what you're doing. But you know, to take a picture that I was viewing of our planet, whether it was a celestial event to like aurora or something, or a comet, or something beautiful that I was witnessing on the surface of the planet, or something as terrific and awe-inspiring as a hurricane, I thought, how am I going to limit to 140 characters what I'm actually feeling right now, looking down into the eye of a hurricane? And but I realized pretty quickly that I didn't have to worry about that, because all you guys took care of the rest. You know, I just needed to get the picture out there, and the rest, it was going to take care of itself, because it's literally a global discussion that goes on, and it goes viral pretty quickly. And I had to be careful, because I actually got in trouble early on, because you guys were actually getting these tweet pictures before NASA was getting the official photos from space. So I sort of got the cart before the horse, and I got politely scolded. You know, it's like, hey, I got a phone call on a private line on board the space station. It's like, hey, we don't mind you doing this Twitter thing, but when you tweet a photo, make sure that we have it, because we get a request coming in for the high resolution photo, which, you know, with these cameras that we have on board, some of these images are 20, 25 megs for an image, you know. So I was having to shrink them down to, I was using TwitPic. I tried Ping FM, and some of you guys scolded me. It's like, Ping's not coming through. So, but I'm sorry for that bad press. But I think Scott Kelly was using Ping, and it was working for him. For some reason, I don't know if it was my technique or something, but so I went back to TwitPic, and so I had to kind of pull those back a little bit and rein them in so I was making sure I was downloading these photos, so when you guys ask for those high-resolution photos, that NASA can politely say, yes, we have that for you, we'll send it to you. And so I kind of got the cart before the horse and got scolded a little bit. So fortunately, it was before I took command of the space station, so I wasn't in trouble. My command wasn't in trouble anyway. But so the event of going through, first of all, launching on the Soyuz spacecraft was quite an adventure, and that's where it all kind of started. Now that Soyuz is really little, and you'll see in this film we took. You know, 6 months of our lives and boiled it down into about 12 minutes of video here. And the other thing that I didn't quite understand, not until I got back, was what a broad spectrum of a global society we can connect with using this type of power. Now, I think now, after we went to Las Vegas and I saw these different companies that are looking for a way to not only connect with each other inside their company, but connect with a customer base and everything else, the power of this is just tremendous. And so I had an opportunity to launch on the space shuttle back in 2007, and so I was real anxious to compare the two vehicles, the Soyuz and also to the space shuttle. And I'll have to tell you that the space shuttle is really pretty a pretty elegant machine. Tracy and I were together this morning, and she described it just perfectly. It's like, you know, we design just contingency backup equipment in our space shuttle to, you know, so if things fail, we have another system that can come back up online and take over that that duty. So we have redundancy built into the space shuttle that's just like pure magic, you know. Now it's the opposite on the Russian side, where the beauty is in the simplicity of their and the robustness of the design. And so it's a very, very simple vehicle, and it's really pretty simple to learn. The hardest part of the training is learning the Russian language. Who speaks Russian? I know we got some folks from Russia, and if you're not a native speaking Russian, it's difficult language to learn. And my cosmonaut buddies have told me that English is actually pretty difficult to learn as well if it's not your first language. And so that was probably the biggest hurdle that I had in my training. But then launching on this vehicle, it seemed to go okay, and I wasn't sure. A little bit of Motrin got me through the 3 hours on the launch pad with my knees in my chest, but riding that vehicle up. Now I was comparing it to my background as a test pilot. So when I flew on the shuttle 3 years ago, I wanted to experience what the vehicle was saying in the way of vibration and the way that it felt. Now a vehicle can, anything that you're flying, like any other flying machine, it talks to you in different ways. It can show you stuff on a screen. But the most important way to, or the more things you can learn actually are through what the vehicle's telling you about. We call seat of the pants. And so I wanted to feel the vibration and the excitement of what it was like to sit on top of that rocket, as compared to the Soyuz. And so flying the space shuttle is actually pretty violent in the first stage when you're on those solid rocket boosters. And I was really surprised at the strength and the power of that thing. And when you're sitting on the space shuttle, you're actually sort of displaced a little bit because the space shuttle's kind of mounted to a big external tank. And so the roll axis, you're actually displaced a little bit, so there's a little bit of a moment arm there. So when that vehicle rolls coming off the pad, you actually feel like you're kind of like on the end of a merry-go-round, you know, kind of being swung out. Where on the Soyuz, the stage is going to space, which is about the same amount of time, about 8.5 minutes to get to space, very, very tame and very calm, because you're sitting on the center line of that thrust. It's kind of coming up through your body. So you feel a little bit of a vibration, like laterally, a little bit of pogo vibration up and down, but pretty smooth going to space. Now, opposite story coming back home. And coming back in the space shuttle, we have, you know, a big vehicle, it's got wings, and it's, so it feels right. You feel like you're in a glider. And so when you're coming back into the Earth's atmosphere, it gets a little warm. It gets like there's a pretty bright light show out the windows. And you get a little bit of a vibration, but it's mostly kind of like a lateral kind of shuffle vibration. But coming home in the Soyuz, totally different story. And I had heard it described as a series of loud explosions followed by a really bad car crash. And and that's pretty much what it was. And it didn't disappoint, that's for sure. And then you land on land underneath chutes. And we actually landed, and we probably didn't get it right the first time because we bounced, and we landed again. And then we rolled over. And I thought, wow, that was one heck of a ride there. So, but it was just a tremendous thrill coming back to the planet. Now, living aboard the space station, I actually would just, it's just living the dream. I mean, it really, truly is. When we had word that the shuttle Discovery had been delayed a little bit, it was actually supposed to come while we were up there. Of course, it just flew just a few weeks ago. So when I was there, it was supposed to come up. And so it was getting delayed a little bit. So they talked about delaying our return home. And I actually felt pretty good about that. I thought, you know, this is a pretty neat place. I'd really like to spend a little more time here, because just being able to capture that view out the window is something that you never really completely get your mind around. And so I tried to share it as best I could with you guys through tweeting these photos, and you'll see some of those in the video as well. But I couldn't seem to replicate what I was actually seeing with my eyes, because you're missing the motion and the vibrant colors in the backdrop of the blackness of space. I couldn't quite, I tried to voice that in my words, but showing the image. So what I tried to do, you probably noticed in the early part of my tweeting, I actually called to our camera folks. I said, you know, I want to replicate what I'm actually seeing with my eyes. And so what lens would be the best for that? So they had me target somewhere between 24 and 28 millimeters, somewhere in there to kind of replicate what we're actually seeing with the curvature of the Earth and everything. And I know Fyodor Yurchikhin was our Soyuz commander going up, and I spent the 6 months with him. He was just a terrific photographer. And he had a 1200 millimeter lens. And so he was more the close up and up close and personal with the photos. And in fact, I remember one day he came floating down to the US segment. He goes, "Hey Doug, check this out." And it was Washington, DC. And we actually saw people walking on the stairs of the Capitol. And I thought, hey, I think I'm gonna need to report this, you know, and then he had pictures of Machu Picchu, and you could see the roads winding up the mountain and everything, just tremendous. And so we actually sort of complimented each other with the way that we were taking photos, and he let me borrow some of his, and he borrowed some of mine, because I wanted to kind of get that more oblique view, to so you could see what it really looks like to look at the curvature of the Earth and to kind of experience the beauty of the Earth from space. Now, Earth from space is, first of all, it's actually more dramatic when you go outside on the spacewalk, because you're sort of in this fishbowl helmet, just like this guy has on here, and it takes you just milliseconds to realize that the only thing between you and the vacuum of space is this thin little visor, and so you take very good care of your visor and your helmet while you're outside on the spacewalk. But the brilliance of the Earth, and actually, the Earth is actually very, very distracting. When you go outside, we go outside to do work, and when you have this just unbelievable contrast of, on the outside of the space station, everything is pretty sterile. You know, it's like either white or black or some form of gray or metallic, you know. And then you look at the shuttle, it's the same way, and so it's kind of boring and unexciting. And you look out into deep space, and the vastness and the darkness of deep space, and it's actually quite frightening. It really, really is. I remember being on STS-120 back 3 years ago. I was in the robotic arm, and I was carrying a big piece of hardware that weighed about 750 pounds, but I was just holding it real tight. I was on the end of that arm, and the arm kind of swung out where I was. Earth and the arm and the space station and the space shuttle were all kind of behind me this way, and the Earth. And I was looking into deep space holding this thing. And because you're floating in space, you're actually floating in your suit as well. So you're kind of bobbing inside of your suit, so you can't really feel that your feet are, like, so I kept kind of kicking my heels out, making sure my feet are locked in there. And I thought, wow, I thought how frightening this really is. You know, just I'm glad that, I hope that tether's holding, you know. And I continue to look down. I remember Paolo Nespoli, who's up there now. Paolo, you may be following him on Twitter. If you're not, you should. He's actually tweeting in English and in Italian, I believe. And really, really a great, he's sending down some great pictures, and he's a wonderful photographer. But Paolo was flying the arm when I was, Stephanie Wilson was flying the arm when Paolo was our intervehicular kind of choreographer when we were outside on STS-120. And so I'm holding this big piece of hardware, staring into deep space, and just really frightened stiff. And Paolo said, "Hey, I need you to give me a glove check." And I'm thinking, like, I'm holding on to this thing, you know. I don't even know if I'm still attached to the arm, you know. I'm just kind of hoping and praying I am. And he wants me to check my gloves, you know, and report back to Houston. And so I had to politely tell him, I was like, "Hey, whenever I, you know, can get back to the safety or confines of either the space station or the payload bay of the shuttle, I'll give you a glove check then." You know, so we kind of kidded around a little bit about that, but floating in that suit is quite a dramatic experience. But then, looking at the Earth, and when you see this blackness of space, and then you look at the Earth is so, like, so much like an explosion of color and life and motion. It's just unbelievable. It really takes your breath away, and you really can't describe it in words. And It's actually very, very distracting when you're trying to do work. And I remember I just kind of had my work in here, and I was doing my work, and I'd see the, you know, here comes the coast of Africa or whatever, you know, and we're traveling at 5 miles per second. So we're actually going around the globe once every 90 minutes. So it's rotating, we're rotating around it pretty quickly. So you really get a sense of speed and motion when you look at the Earth, and it is quite distracting. And I remember specifically saying, oh, I was so thankful that every 45 minutes we either get a sunrise or a sunset. So I was ready for that sun to go down so I wouldn't have this explosion of color right in my face so I could get my work done. I thought, well, surely it'll be better when we get into darkness, when the Earth gets into darkness, and not so. I remember the sun going down and I heard Paolo call out, okay, make sure your lights are on, your glove heaters are on, because it gets pretty cold in the darkness as well. And then I started doing my work and I saw something kind of like flash, you know, below me, and I looked and I saw like a puffs of lightning, you know, on the Earth, and then like fingers of lightning shooting out, and then an aurora kind of dancing like across the sky at the northern pole. And I thought, man, this place is, what a raging place. And I looked down, of course you could see the city lights, and I thought, I was praying for the sun to come up, you know. So it's actually a little more distracting at night because you begin, but at the Earth at night is so, that's why I tried to focus a lot of my attention on taking the city lights at night or coastlines at night, because it is just mesmerizing what happens when the Earth goes into shadow and you're looking at the darkness of the Earth, and then you can still see this raging place in the middle of this vast sea of nothing. And that really makes you think what a wonderful place we live in. And I always thought to myself, you know, ever since I was a kid, I wanted to be an astronaut. I thought I worked so many years and studied so long to come to space, and I was there now. And I thought to myself, I said, how wonderful it would have been had I been born and lived in space, and I was able to see that blue planet. I think like, man, one day I want to go there, you know. And it was such a strong feeling that it's way more profound than actually my dream of going to space. I thought, what a beautiful place. And if you're looking at that place from deep space, you'd think to yourself, man, that looks like an explosion of life and color. I want to go there, you know. I want to see what that place is like. And so coming back to the planet was just a wonderful, wonderful experience as well. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later. But I wanted to show you this video here in just a moment. I wanted to kind of lead in with this that Stephanie mentioned that, you know, we had a remember where you were when. We had a moment like that last summer when it was July 31st, and as a matter of fact, and it was 11:32 GMT, which will be forever emblazoned on my mind. But it was a Saturday night. And we operate off of Greenwich Mean Time on board the space station. So normally we get up at 6 a.m. Greenwich, you know, which is in Houston. Depending on daylight savings time, it may be midnight or maybe 1 in the morning, and in Houston. And then we'd work till 9:30 in the evening Greenwich, and we're scheduled to go to bed, you know. So we would normally that's when my best tweeting time came, you know, because I had something that profound that happened that day, or something that I saw that I got a chance to go to the window on, or something that Fyodor floated over. He goes, hey, check this out, you know. And I thought, let me tweet that, you know. And so anyway, going through this experience, it was a Saturday evening. It was July 31st. It was 11:32 p.m. Greenwich. And Tracy and I were the only ones awake at that time. Everybody else had gone off to their crew quarters to go to sleep. And I had just turned the treadmill off. I'd done a late run that night. We have a treadmill on board. And I saved my run till like 10 o'clock, and I did my run on that treadmill. And then the only thing they asked us to do was, they could shut it down from Houston, but they asked us when we're finished with the treadmill, just go ahead and turn it off. And it's just a couple button throws on a computer, and actually shuts off the smoke alarm system on that rack, and then shuts the system down to kind of conserve a little bit of power. Well, we had done that about 30 seconds before the alarms went off. And And so you'll see a little bit of that in the video as well. That's exactly what we experienced. But the alarms went off, red lights, yellow lights, cautions, warnings, and sirens going off for about 2 hours. We kept silencing the alarm, but they kept coming back because the space station was dying before our eyes. And there's something very mortal in the way that you feel when you're inside of a spaceship and it's kind of slowly dying before your eyes. And it's, but you know, the experience and coming through that, and I tweeted a little bit about that when we were going through that experience, because we weren't quite sure what happened. And there was a period on board where it's like, well, we think it's the pump and this ammonia pump on the outside of the space station. And I knew that, you know, dealing with this ammonia, we had practiced this before changing out a pump, and we had an extra one on board that was outside. I thought, well, I think they're going to go out and they're going to have us go outside and try to replace this pump. And this thing is huge. It's like the size of the stage that I'm standing on, this little section here. And it weighs about 1,000 pounds, a little less than 1,000 pounds. Now, everything's weightless in space, but F still equals MA in space. And so when you have mass, you still have to worry about forces to begin to start that mass moving and to stop that mass from moving. And so when you're hanging onto it with your two little paws, it could easily get away from you, especially if you're holding onto handles that are not really in a symmetric configuration on this mass. And so we'll talk a little bit about that later. But so it was an event on board where we thought, gosh, we don't know what we're going to do. We looked at each other. We thought, how are we going to get out of this mess? Because we had to essentially shut down all of the science on board, shut down all the laboratories, you know, half the lights were out kind of thing, and half power, you know, we're conserving everything. And we thought, you know, if we have one more pump, and if it goes, we go back to the blue planet. And not a good thing to leave the space station. I keep saying unmanned, but unpersoned at that time. And so not a good situation to be in. And so we were kind of hanging on the ragged edge there. And we looked at each other. We thought, you know what? I've seen this in the movies before. So this is going to be really, really, it's probably not going to be very elegant, but they're going to come up with a solution. And we're going to get through this. And it's going to end up being one of NASA's finest hours. And it was. It was unlike anything I had ever experienced. I've been in the military now for 28 years. And I'd never experienced teamwork like I experienced last summer. And it took us about 3 weeks and three spacewalks. It took us about 22, 23 hours outside. But we got this thing fixed. I took an ammonia shower on the first, I kid with the students I go talk to that we don't have any shower on board the space station. So I went for 6 months without a shower. We all did. And but I took an ammonia shower outside, and I was a little bit afraid of that because I knew that this anhydrous ammonia was going to be really deadly if we got a drop of it back inside the airlock. And so we ended up doing a very long spacewalk. I think it was the longest spacewalk out of the ISS airlock in the history of the ISS. And it was a little over 8 hours. And some of that time was spent trying to get this ammonia off our suits. Because when it dries or when it hits, if it hits your suit before it sublimes or sublimates, it creates like a waxy surface. It looks like candle wax actually on the white suits. And so Tracy and I had to sort of just inspect each other. If we found ammonia, we take this hot, essentially turn this metal tool into a hot iron. We stick it in the sun, let it get to about 300 degrees in the direct sunlight, and then touch it on the ammonia to help it to sublimate. So we did that for a little bit of time, trying to get rid of all this ammonia. And the fun never stops on board the space station, I'll tell you. But through this whole process of tweeting, I got to be just acquaintances at first, and then real good friends with John Androsek and the lead singer of Five for Fighting. I don't know if you've heard their music, if you like their music. I love their music, and I was asked, you know, I was like, you know, Five for Fighting, I've heard that before. I couldn't figure out where the name came from, but it's actually a hockey term. Are there any hockey players out there? Okay, well, anyway, not many. But I played hockey when I was a kid. But the term Five for Fighting is you get, you know, we'd always go to hockey games as a kid because we always wanted to see the fights. That was the most exciting part when you're a kid. And so But you get 5 minutes in the penalty box for fighting. And so if you're caught fighting in a hockey game and your whistle blows from the referee and you get sent to the penalty box, the call is 5 for fighting. And so John is a big hockey fan and became a big fan of space through our whole experience and our tweeting and our sharing with each other as a global society. And so 5 for Fighting has lent their music to us. And so you'll see this video and still imagery collection is set to their music. And then afterward, enjoy this. At the very end of it, there's some tweets from space, and you may, if you're following at @astro_wheels while I was in space, you'll recognize a lot of the photos. The tweets won't be there, but it'll be the location, and then the actual twit pic that I sent, and you'll recognize some of those. And then we're gonna come back together after the video, and you guys be ready to answer any kind of questions that you have, and I'll stay as long as you guys need me to answer those. Okay, so let's drop the lights and bring up the video, and you guys enjoy.
Was a man back in 95 whose heart ran out of summers, but before he died I asked him, wait, what's the sense in life? Come over me, come over me. He said, son, why you gotta sing that tune? Catch a Dylan song or some eclipse of the moon. Let an angel swing and make you swoon, then you will see. You will see. Then he said, here's a riddle for you. Find the answer. There's a reason for the world. You and I.
And ignition and liftoff of the Soyuz rocket. Shannon Walker, Fyodor Yurchikhin, and Doug Wheelock begin their journey on the 100th launch on behalf of the International Space Station.
Batter swings and the summer flies. As I look into my angel's eyes, a song plays on while the moon is hiding. Over me, something comes over me. I guess we're big and I guess we're small. If you think about it, man, you know we got it all. 'Cause we're all we got on this bouncing ball. And I love you free. you and I.
Station Houston, Space Ground 1. We see your messages, and no immediate action required. We'll get back to you when we have more information.
Okay, we're standing by.
Station Houston, Space Ground 1 for ETCS warning.
Chris, go ahead.
We're showing that the Loop Alpha ETCS pump is down. You have no cooling on Loop Alpha. No immediate action for you on the ground. We're going to be stepping into warning 2.820.
For a moment, and she feels better than ever, and we're on fire, making our way back from Mars. 15, there's still time for you, time to buy and time to lose. 15, there's never a wish better than this, when you only got 100 years to live.
Receive and accept command of the International Space Station from you. Thank you. Help me to believe it. What kind of
monstrous thoughts now. Should there be people or peoples? Money, funny pedestals for folks who never pay. Raise your arm and choose your steeple. Don't be shy, the satellites can look.
Relinquish command of the International Space Station to you, my friend and crewmate.
Thank you, Doug. I assume command. It's a real honor and a privilege to take command of this great ship, the International Space Station.
What kind of world do you want?
Thank you.
That was our mission. We had to select roughly 12 minutes of our 6 months of our lives, and so we tried to pick our favorite videos. Hope you enjoyed it. And now I think we're just going to open up to any questions you might have for Stephanie or me. And
we have two microphones. We have two microphones, so make sure you wait for one of us with a microphone to come around to you.
Colonel, Commander, thank you very much for everything you've shared with us. There's a lot of things that I've seen in your experiences, things that you can control, the math, the science, the logistics. One thing that's completely beyond our control, your dreams. How have they changed since your experiences?
How have my dreams changed? So profound. I've actually kind of, this whole experience has kind of turned me into, I'm an engineer at heart and I'm a test pilot. And so what first convinced me of tweeting, and I'll get to this in just a second, because I'm very concerned about actually the dream that not only our dreams in this room, but the dreams that we're passing on to our children as well. What's in this direction of space exploration for them, and what kind of torture we're going to pass to them. But when I was first looking at this tweeting thing, because I'm sort of got an engineering mindset, and I didn't really know. I obviously have deep, profound feelings, but normally I'm not real good, like probably a lot of men, I'm not real good, and a lot of engineers, not real good at expressing my feelings. But I read the story just before I went to Russia, got a chance to go out to the West Coast and spend some time in San Francisco, and actually up in the Redwoods, and I went with a friend to 232 Santa Margarita Drive in Menlo Park. And I thought, well, why am I going here? You know, it's a pretty modest little place, kind of a small home. And but in that garage is where Google started. And the friend that I was with wanted to show me that. He was a Stanford graduate, and he wanted to show me where Google all began, you know. And I began to become interested in the story of, because these were two Stanford graduate students that were engineers. And what I found enlightening about their story was, of course, we all use Google now, and I don't think I'm supposed to state my case of whether or not I use Google, but I do, and probably like you, and it's become really a kind of a global force for us as a search engine, and so a lot of people use it. But it was started out in this garage. Actually, it started on the Stanford campus under a different name, but Stanford kicked them out because they were using too much bandwidth and sort of dimming the lights on campus, and so they ended up going to this small garage out in Menlo Park. And when it was Larry Page and Sergey Brin, when they first started, the founders of Google, the way the story goes is that they sold the idea to one of the co-founders of Sun Microsystems, and he invested $100,000 and gave them a check made out to Google, and the company Google had not been formed yet. So it was quite interesting that it took several months for them to get to this garage, set up business, actually, you know, incorporate the name, and then to where they could actually cash this check, their first investment. But one thing that I thought was interesting coming out of that is they talked about when they hired their first business person to kind of take over as CEO of that company, because they were just two young engineers, and they kind of kidded that they did it to bring on some adult supervision to keep an eye on them. But the profound statement that came sort of in return to that was that engineers are devoid of any emotional intellect. And so they know how things work, but they have no idea what the rest of the world thinks. And and so they said they really took that to heart, and because what they didn't know is that side of them that could really reach other people and inspire other people. And they knew how these things worked and how to build a wonderful search engine, but to get it to be a global force was something much different. and they needed some assistance, someone who's more talented in that area to bring it to light. And that was the same way I thought, well, you know, I could do this Twitter thing. You know, I could do it. And, you know, I've been school trained as an engineer and as a test pilot, so you sort of keep your own personal feelings close hold. You try to be objective as possible in your evaluation of things. And so that's what really opened up. And it allowed me to experience to the full my dream of flying in space. And so it made it an experience that was, because I was looking for, I realized that the completion of this dream couldn't come until I could share it with other people. And, you know, I wish that I could bring you all to that cupola and see those shots that we took out of those windows. I can't do that, so what's the next best thing is to try to show you what I'm seeing and try to express how that makes me feel as a human, you know, to look at our planet in this way. And I think it's the same for my dream hasn't changed. It just, I've realized how much we need each other. I mean, this is not only the space business, but anything that you're, any kind of business that you might be involved in, or even, gosh, socially, I mean, we all need each other. And it's not a Lone Ranger business, you know? And so I think that my dream sort of expanded a little bit. I allowed it to expand by talking to you guys and to get to just let other people enjoy and experience what I was seeing. And all I really needed to do was to send a tweet, and then you guys took off with it. And it began a global discussion that I think is really, really important for all of us and the way that we take care of our planet. And also the way that we nurture dreams and those coming behind us, not only in each other, but especially our children and our grandchildren as well, as to how we gonna pass this torch of discovery and exploration, because there are other things right now that are sort of captivating our attention. And, you know, we're dealing with a fairly good budget issues and economic, actually globally, economic issues as well. And so it's, you know, it's hard to be another person in line going asking for more money for exploration and stuff when actually we should just be doing everything we can to keep that dream alive. Because when I look at kids now, and I most enjoyable part of my job is to taking this message to schools and talking to our kids, you know, K through 12 and college age kids, and people that are real at the beginning of their professional careers, because, you know, it's cool. I get to wear a blue suit. I get to fly in space. And so what they're looking at me, I know now that it's, they're looking at me saying, okay, the dream came true for you. How about for me? You know, is there something in this passion for discovery and exploration there I can live my dream as well? And to understand that other people's dreams are not the same as ours, but our solemn obligation is to nurture those dreams. And I'm so thankful that we're not all the same and we don't share those same dreams, but the dream to reach the very top of your game and the very top of your potential, I think is alive in all of us, and especially now so much more in our children, that it's incumbent upon us to kind of nurture that. So I don't know if I answered your question, but my dream really, really kind of changed. I was, when I looked at the Earth, you know, I have my own personal feelings and beliefs. I'm a person, I happen to be a person of faith. And so but I also have a very scientific mind. And so the two don't clash for me. You know, when I look at our planet and at our universe and our solar system, it's just, I feel like right now orbiting the Earth, I feel like what it would have been like for Columbus to kind of set sail, go out where the water is a little rough, just above your head, you know, where it's a little too deep, but you're still in sight of land, and really didn't set out for the new world, you know. And I really think that that's kind of where we are, and we need to, and to really go deeper and further is going to take a bunch of dreamers, And we're hoping that our children will rise up and that we'll take that torch of dreaming and take it to further, deeper and further into our solar system and back to, you know, going boldly again. So it's a great question. Thank you. I'll go on and on. Stop me if I'm talking too long again. So right here.
Colonel Wheeler, I have a question. Where do you see the space program, well, in this case, NASA, in 10 years?
10 years. Okay, that's a nice segue to that. Was that question planted, by the way? Well, that's tough. What's your name?
Carson.
Ryson. Okay, thank you. That's a very good question. Where do I see NASA in the next 10 years? You know, when I look back, we're getting ready to celebrate the 30th anniversary of the first space shuttle launch. And we've only been doing this for 50 years, you know, the space business for 50 years. And I know for people less than 50, that seems like a long time. But those of us who are around that age and older, I don't want to say older, I want to say more seasoned and more experienced, realize that how far we've come in that 50 years, not only in the way of space travel and what we can do now as far as these deep space probes, and we've been to the moon, and will we go back? I don't know. I hope so. Will we go to Mars? I'm not sure. It won't be me, but maybe it'll be you. And when I go to our, especially to talk to our kids, you know, what's to come in the next 50 years, I can only imagine. I mean, just think about what's happened in the last 50 years in the way of space travel, and not only as we're expanding as a global society now as well, working together with our Russian partners. You know, when I was a kid, if you would have told me that I would have launched to space on a Russian rocket and come back in that capsule and being wearing a Russian spacesuit, a flight suit, in front of a crowd in Washington, D.C., I would have thought you were crazy, you know, just only 20 years ago. And so that these magical things happen when we globally open our minds to what we can accomplish next. And in 10 years, I'm not sure. I don't think we'll be to Mars by then, but what's really, really exciting for me is I think within 25 to 30 years, we'll be sending the first people to Mars. Now, again, I hope to be in a rocking chair somewhere with a big old big cup of coffee or a glass of tea watching on TV or whatever. But what's very exciting is that our astronauts are selected usually in their mid-30s. So when I was selected in mid-30s, it's kind of the center of the bell curve. So those first astronauts that will take us to the surface of Mars and will live that experience through their eyes somewhere in our school system right now. It's probably a kid that's in elementary school or kids that are in elementary school right now. And that's very exciting to me. And I mean, because you think back years back before we even had Apollo, you know, Neil Armstrong sat in a classroom in an elementary school at one point. And if you would have told those teachers that were Neil Armstrong's teachers back then that, hey, this is going to be the first human to step foot on the moon, they would have thought you were crazy. You know, just like we thought with the Wright brothers as well. I mean, these things, when these dreams are allowed to expand and really take root, there's no telling what we can do. And in 10 years, I hope that we have a new rocket, a new vehicle to replace the space shuttle. I know that we'll have an operating space station still. There'll probably be commercial companies that will be resupplying that space station. There may be a long-duration flyer like yourself going to space and staying for 6 months, maybe a year on the space station. One of the things we're trying to do when we live for long duration on the space station is sort of replicate travel to another planetary body or another body in our solar system. And so we fly for 6 months to sort of replicate what would happen to the human body during that transit time. And so maybe by then we'll be flying people on commercial vehicles to the space station, and then NASA will have a new vehicle to take these brave young astronauts out to some place a little bit further away. You know, like Columbus, instead of staying where he can see the land, you know, just set sail for the new world. And it, I think it's going to be someone probably your age that's going to take us there, and that's very exciting to me. In 10 years, I think we'll have a new vehicle that will take us deeper into the solar system, and it's very exciting as well. So, and then in 20 years, we're going to see you as a young astronaut. We'll keep a desk open for you down in Houston, and then in 25 or 30 years, we'll put a spacesuit on you. We'll blast you off to Mars. Would you go?
Maybe.
Maybe. Okay. Okay. So that's a very good question. And so, you know, but the realities of it are that all this takes a lot of money. But when you can engage not only our education system, you know, our universities, our schools, and all of industry, get them engaged, and it creates a kind of a fire that burns. And I think it's a fire that really burns inside of all of us, you know, for this passion for exploration, going somewhere. We're not sure what we're going to find when we go there, but we know it's going to be something wonderful. And it's going to take a moment like that when we pull together as a global society and also as a throughout our education levels in this country and also globally, and our industry as well. And I think partnering up, we can go and do magical things. And I hope I see you there when I'm drinking that cup of coffee in my rocking chair. Okay? Great questions. Okay. Right. I guess you have the mic. I better let the microphone to people. Go ahead.
Commander, thank you so much for not only your time today, but your service to our country and service to the world. I'm Kathleen, Twitter handle clearjobs.net. You obviously have been challenged by many technologies over your entire career, and you had certain expectations of what this technology was going to bring to you and how it was going to challenge you. When someone sort of said, okay, you're now going to do Twitter, obviously a new technology, something that challenged you, what were some of the things that you preconceived it was going to do, and what were some of the surprises you found once you started tweeting?
Yeah, I think what I expected was totally different than what reality was has become for me. What I expected was, I was terrified of living my life in a soundbite form, you know. And I thought, you know what, I won't be able to express myself in 140 characters, and I just don't want to do it because I want to feel here's what I thought to myself. Okay, I thought, who is so bored that they really want to know when I'm going to the bathroom or something, you know? And I don't really want to know when somebody's heading off to the bathroom, or, you know, it's nice to get, hey, I just ate at this restaurant, it's awesome, or something like that. That's a good tweet to get. But I thought, you know, surely, first of all, I don't want people to know when I'm going off to the bathroom. And I'm simplifying it, but this is what was running through my head, you know. I thought, you know, if I don't have something profound to say, I just don't want to be a bunch of empty words out there in soundbite form. I want to be part of something a little bit larger than that. And when I first didn't sign up for Twitter, when it was mentioned to me by encouraged by NASA headquarters, I didn't see the end game in it, you know. And I just thought, you know, it's going to be sort of a waste of my time, is what I thought. Okay, that's how I thought going in. And then now experiencing it, it's actually kind of fun, you know. And I'm sure that you guys are here because it really opens up. I mean, look at the way that social media. I think I really think, and I told the folks in Las Vegas as well, that because these were very a lot of companies represented there, I thought you need to either embrace this or you're going to get left behind. You really are as a business, especially as a business that serves customers. If you're not actively involved in social media, and that is a choice of yours, then I think, especially in a global society that we're in, you're choosing to be left behind in a global discussion that could really be life-changing for you. And I mean, I see all the things that are happening from Japan now, all the things that are, I think some of the first communication that was coming out of there was through social media forms. And so, I mean, look at what's going on in the Middle East and over there, and some of the social media that's sending information out, sort of getting the reality out there where we never really knew what reality was, just whatever we were getting from a news agency or something, you know. And I think now that probably as a society we're getting a little tired of, I can't remember the last time, it's very seldom that I turn on a TV and I want to look at a person telling me what the news is, you know. I want to be part of this dynamic global society, and doing this, I really feel like that I am, and so that's how far I've come with it. I can't remember the last time I read a newspaper, and I think that's the way our society is just living now. I mean, we've got busy lives, we're very mobile, and taking care of this in a soundbite fashion. I thought, so I'm gonna actually my first agreement with NASA is that, okay, I'll do this, but I'm only gonna do it if I can send a picture. So if you look at my early tweets, I think my first 150 tweets were there's a picture attached, because I thought I'm not just gonna put words out there because I can't imagine that somebody's interested in what I have to say, but I think they may be interested in what I'm seeing with my eyes. And that was kind of how I got sucked in to the world, to the dark side. So, let me go to the mics. Okay. 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 Right here. Who has the mic? Okay.
Doug, good to see you again. Bill Atwood,
hey,
from the
Bill,
25th.
Great.
Gosh, see you.
We flew together back.
Welcome home.
So, years ago.
Yeah. Welcome home. It's been about 27 years, and to think that
that's amazing.
To think that all this would happen, and here you are. But it's been thrilling to watch your progress and to get the pictures back on Twitter. And my wife says, "Are you looking at those space photos again?" I said, "Yes, I am." And it's so exciting. At times, it would bring tears to my eyes. And my sons, who are named John and Glenn, by the way.
All right.
you know, it's just been a mind expanding experience. For us, and I, there's not a week that doesn't go by where I tried to say, imagine this, put yourself in that position, what it would be like to step out, and the tweets have been so poetic in the way you've described the experience, the visual explosion of life and colors against that sea of darkness. It's just been amazing, and I'm so proud of you.
Thank you.
And to think that. And I got to tell you, it's been 27 years, but the Doug Wheelock you see here he's got that same smile. He had it 27 years ago, long before he could even spell NASA. And but he hasn't changed a bit. And I'm personally thrilled to see good things happen to good people. And as a boy, astronauts were my hero back then, and nothing's changed a bit.
Thank you,
and
Bill.
Sir, I salute you, and thank you for your contribution to space.
Thank you, Bill. Bill and I flew Army helicopters together back in the 80s when I first met Bill, and he was a flight instructor back then. And then he went off to fly with American Airlines. I believe you're still with American.
I'm still with American Airlines, 767 captain
so
now.
So you passing out buddy passes?
I can hook you up.
But anyway, thanks, Bill. Thanks. I really appreciate it. It's great to see you. Good to meet John Glenn. So good to meet you guys. So, okay, right here.
Hi, my name is Claudia.
Hi, Claudia.
And actually, I have a 2 years old, 2.5 years old at home now, Dylan. And he loves everything space. So actually, his first word was moon.
Oh.
And now, yes, not mom and dad, was moon. And he loves everything space. He loves, you know, astronauts and space stations. And, you know, the NASA channel, we watch all the launchings and everything. He just loves it. So you were saying before that this was a dream for you since you were a little boy. So how did that happen? And for the kids now, what's your perspective? Can they dream of being an astronaut? And
absolutely.
What they can do, and what we as parents can do to help them?
Very good question. And I, you know, on top of this question, you guys all heard it, and it's really the. It's really involves all of us because we're all ordinary people. And when I was a kid, I was 9 years old when we landed Apollo 11 on the moon. And I grew up in a tiny little town in upstate New York, and I went to a very, very small school. The town is actually smaller now than it was when I was a kid because the opportunities for young people coming out of school have evaporated up there. So the town is actually smaller, and the school is smaller as well. And I remember I came into fourth grade after that summer in 69. I came into fourth grade, and we had a teacher that just finished her training, and she was somewhere, I think she went to New York, college in New York City, and she came up to this little country school. And of course, when she was teaching us science, I mean, we just landed people on the moon that July, and so now we're coming into school. She had lots of information to begin her teaching with. And I remember her looking at me and say, like, wouldn't you want to do that? Wouldn't you want to be an astronaut? And I thought to myself, of course I went, you know. But I thought in my heart, I thought, this lady has no idea who she's talking to, you know. I mean, this is such an ordinary little place, and I'm just like a ordinary little kid that she has no idea. Because those dreams back then were reserved for somebody that was, you know, larger than life, that was extraordinary. And so I didn't allow myself to dream wearing this suit, you know, because it was an impossible dream at that time. And I think about how it must have been for little girls that were that age, because then, you know, it was all guys and it was all military test pilots, you know, they were early astronauts. And I thought, man, that's a world that I know nothing about, and it's a world totally separate than mine. And so I didn't allow myself to dream that because I didn't think it was attainable. But it's the same thing for our kids now, that we're all, you know, if we're very truthful about it, we're all just ordinary kids, you know, coming from an ordinary little place, and nothing really extraordinary about us. The school we went to might be a top-notch school, but we probably weren't the first, you know, the number one student. And there's always someone better at what you're doing. And so you feel, I remember when I got to West Point, I'd never worked so hard to feel so average in all my life, you know? And I've been doing that my entire life, you know? I went to the test pilot school and I thought, again, I never worked so hard to feel so average in all my life, you know? But it's the truth of the matter is that we hold, you know, I think that we have the tendency to hold that inside because we feel so average that we don't allow ourselves to dream these things, you know. And maybe the dream is for them to be an astronaut. Maybe the dream is to be a teacher or a doctor or whatever it is that they want to become in their life and in their profession. I think it's incumbent upon us, what can we do to listen to what kids have to say. And when they confess their dreams to us, is to nurture those dreams. And because anything is possible, I mean, it really is. I mean, you think back just in my lifetime, the way the world has changed now, where now an ordinary kid coming from an ordinary place can become an astronaut. And an ordinary kid coming from a very ordinary beginnings can become president of the United States. And so any dream that you have for yourself and for that our children have, my encouragement would be to just nurture those dreams and listen to the kids. Now when I go into schools, especially when I'm in a classroom, I don't do this in an auditorium setting, but if I'm in a classroom with kids, I first ask them, I said, who in this class is really brave? And they think I'm going to talk about putting them on a rocket or something. And they all raised their hand. And I said, who's brave enough to share their dream for their life with everybody else in the classroom? A lot of those hands go down, but some of them, and it only takes one for those kids to raise their hand and say, I want to be a fireman when I grow up, or I want to be a teacher, or whatever it is. And sometimes there's little chuckles and giggles because we're all very ordinary. We look at each other as ordinary as well. And so these dreams seem impossible to our kids. And I think we allow our kids and our society to put limitations on what we can dream. And I would ask you and implore you as parents, and if you're a teacher in here, especially as teachers, to knock down those barriers and allow your children's dreams to kind of flourish and develop over the years, because they will change, just as you mentioned in the back. As our kids grow and experience life, they'll change, their dreams will morph into something that they can actually become. And it's a quite a wonderful process to watch a child become, you know. And so anyway, thank you for your question. And that's that would be my encouragement is to if your child is only two and dreaming of the moon, well then.
Mother, I don't want
him to don't, you don't want him to go to the moon? Okay. One day you may go, you're going to the moon. So I've been told that a couple times in my life. But anyway, just to nurture those dreams. Go ahead, Stephanie, I'm sorry.
Hi, Colonel Wheelock. Glenn Gonzalez from Baltimore, Maryland.
Nice to see
welcome
you.
Back to Earth.
Thank you.
I've been following your expedition ever since, you know, like from launch to landing. And just a quick question about all of the pictures that you've taken while you were on orbit. Was there one or two shots that you found absolutely breathtaking?
Yes, let me think of a couple that... I think what mesmerized me the most, more than anything, was the aurora. Because, and second, I think second to that would be the hurricanes that we witnessed. We were on board during the peak of the hurricane season, and we saw several monsters out there in the Atlantic, and actually a couple typhoons in the Pacific as well. And I think those were probably the most breathtaking things that I saw. The aurora, because I tried really hard when we were flying over the eye of a hurricane. It's real hard to pick up motion on the surface of the planet. Now, you can see contrails from jets. You can see flow patterns in like ocean currents. You can see the effects of wind, but you can't really see things moving on the planet. And I thought, I bet if I looked right down in the eye of that hurricane, I bet I could see that eye wall spinning. I couldn't do it. But the aurora moves, and it's like sort of like paint strokes. And actually, a couple moments, I felt like the glow was actually coming up underneath of us. So we're actually inside of the aurora, arm tendrils coming out, you know. So that was probably the most awe-inspiring of the events that I saw, was that because it really added a new dimension to this planet that we live on. And so that probably took my breath away. In fact, the others on the crew said, what's the deal with all the aurora photos? You know, because there, I tweeted like several in a row, and you know, I had a couple friends actually emailed me and said, hey, how about something other than aurora? but that really kind of took my breath away. And then seeing the hurricanes was pretty dramatic as well. But everything in its own right had a very, very special place for me. And, you know, because there are lots of places on this planet I've never been, and to see those with my eyes, like Kamchatka, it's like Jurassic Park, you know? I mean, it's like in one view at Kamchatka, you can see, you know, 60, 70 active volcanoes going off, you know? And it's just like, wow, I never knew this place existed. I mean, I knew it existed. And first one in a Risk game when I was a kid, yeah, could you take that part of Kamchatka? But looking out at it and seeing that beauty, the glaciers in Patagonia were like, wow, I'd heard about them, but seeing them from space and then zooming in and seeing the beauty of that part of the world was just took your breath away, you know? And then, of course, seeing the city lights of, you can see, map out coastlines, and you begin to see like a global society and how the lights define, first of all, landscape, obviously. So you can clearly see coastlines by landscape. You can see mountain ranges because they're all dark, and you can see the cities kind of blending in between the mountain passes. You can see the lights there. The difference between North and South Korea was breathtaking. You know, when you see the lights of Seoul and then the lights of South Korea, you can clearly see the darkness as you come into North Korea, in the again, just technological development, development of roads and actually just the advances that we have in our different societies. It's really kind of breathtaking as well. So I can't really pick out one particular tweet. I really like that 100th tweet that I sent because that aurora was pretty amazing. It actually looked like rain. It looked like we were inside of a rainstorm. It was kind of, that picture really doesn't do it justice, but I wish I could capture it. You know, I wish I could just do like this with my eyes and it would be like a saved image, you know, 500 megs or something, and I could downlink it to you guys. And so you could see it, and it's just really takes your breath away.
Hi, well, thank you so much for sharing your pictures. There were many days when it just made my day to get up in the morning or go to bed at night, just seeing one of those wonderful pictures. I had a question, actually, completely unrelated to this. When you come back after spending 6 months in space, how do your muscles take it? I've had a chance to speak with a couple of astronauts who spent just 2 weeks when they went aboard their space shuttle, and when they came back, they kind of had a little bit of, you know, obviously adjusting. Did you lose a lot of muscle mass, and how long did it take you to get back to what's considered normal?
Great questions. Great question. I'll try to be brief, but it's... But I'm actually still dealing with some of the effects. I've got a pair of glasses in my pocket here that I'm trying to go without them, but my vision changed while I was in space. I'll describe that here in just a minute. And but we have exercise countermeasures in space. So we have a treadmill, and we have an advanced resistive exercise device. You saw it in the video. It's kind of like a universal gym. It has a bar on it and a cable with a pulley system that we can add weight to it and essentially get a good workout. And then we have the stationary bike, of course. And so coming back and landing after 6 months, I actually felt pretty strong. I felt like I could stand up, you know, and hold myself upright. Now, there were some muscles that were very sore, like the back of my neck, holding your head up, because for 6 months you don't have to hold your head up. It just kind of floats, you know. Just stays attached by my little pencil neck, you know. And so those muscles were really sore. I thought, wow, it's like, and I was kind of getting fatigued holding my head up when I got back. But I didn't really feel like in my arms and legs, I didn't feel like really heavy. And so that and that soreness kind of went away after about a week of rehabilitation. And then you have the balance stuff going on, you know, so your inner ear kind of goes into hibernation. Your proprioceptive cues, you know, so the things that kind of keep us balanced when we're sitting, when we're standing, walking, what have you, and our sense of up and down usually comes from the system. We do get some of it from our eyes. And when you go to space, all of it's got to start coming through your eyes, and your brain's not quite used to that yet. And so when that proprioceptive part of you, of your brain, kind of goes into hibernation, it can be confusing to your body, and you can get some awareness in your stomach, you know, so you can feel some nausea and you can get the trifecta, you know, when you get into sickness and stuff like that. Fortunately, I didn't get that far in my, but that goes away after a couple of days, and the same thing coming back to Earth. Your stomach feels a little uneasy as well coming back to Earth, but that goes away pretty quickly. Your balance system, for about 4 or 5 days, I felt like a little bit of a lag. Like if I'd start to lean, it'd take about 4 seconds for my body and brain to figure out I need to kind of push this way to kind of. So you kind of do this little penguin walk, you know, when you first get back. And when you see the shuttle astronauts walking underneath the space shuttle just after they landed, you watch their feet. We only have 2 more shuttle launches left, so watch their feet when they come out. They have a wide gait. And they're probably turning their head and their body at the same axis, because if you do this, it can kind of manifest itself as kind of a tipping forward. For me, it was, if I turned left, I felt like I was pitching forward, and if I turned right, I felt like I was flipping backwards. And so that takes a couple of days for that to kind of even out as well. The one thing that's kind of lingering for me is that when this fluid shifts in your body and you're in microgravity for a long duration, the intracranial pressure that you have inside of your head actually increases. And the first few days you feel real full, you know, and your face is kind of puffy and your eyes are puffy. And then after a couple weeks, you kind of diurese a lot of that, and you actually operate in space pretty dehydrated. You wouldn't be able to function that way And we actually rehydrate. We drink a lot of fluid before we come back into the atmosphere because we need to, this fluid's going to redistribute, and so we need to become hydrated again. But this increased pressure actually pushes on the back of your eyes and changes the shape of your retina and changes your vision. I was like, hey, you guys never told me about that before I went to space, you know. Kind of raised my hand, you know. But it makes sense, you know. And we're actually, for the medical community, we're actually replicating, you know, increased intracranial pressure that some folks that are battling these diseases here on the planet that actually increase the intracranial pressure, you know, people that have spinal problems or with the lining of the brain. And same thing, they have these vision changes as well quite often because of this increased intracranial pressure. So now we're a control group, and right now I'm a control group of one. Scott's back now, so he'll add to the second to the control group. But because we're not experiencing this disease, but we're replicating the same intracranial pressure and vision change that they're doing tests on us now to see what the mechanism is that's causing this. And is there something in the way of pharmaceuticals or rehabilitation, diet, that can help get this pressure back down into a normal category? So that's actually the most lingering thing for me right now. And that affects my my response to like relative motion. If I'm driving, I kind of drive like this now, 10 and 2, you know? And if I have cars going faster or coming by me, my brain is still kind of lagging a little bit in calculating closure rates, you know, closure and opening rates. And so that system is still getting back to normal for me. So great question.
Hi, Doug.
Hi.
Thank you very much. I'm over here.
Okay, there you are.
Oh, yeah,
okay.
Yeah. Thank you certainly very much for today and also sharing your wonderful experiences aboard the space station through Twitter and everything else. We really enjoyed it. I know it was really nice to share it with my students in the classroom.
Absolutely.
So we really appreciate that. In fact, one of the students wanted to know, what does it take to work at NASA, whether it be a scientist, engineer, or even an astronaut? Now that he's seen you, he definitely is leaning that way again. So,
well, what I encourage our kids is to, especially if you have a love of math, science, engineering, something like that, the life sciences and material sciences, in those categories, if you're interested in that, those areas, we can use your help at NASA. And obviously there are other ways to actually work at NASA, but if you want to work in the engineering department or become an astronaut, normally it's folks that are interested in those type of fields. And so I encourage kids, don't be afraid of those fields, because we need good, sharp students, because these new ideas are going to come from these fresh minds, these dreamers that are coming up through our school now. So that would be my encouragement, because normally and I know as a teacher, thank you for your service to our kids and to our country as well, by really, I mean, I think we put a lot of burden on what other teachers do we have in the room? We have a couple teachers. Well, anyway, I think we put a huge burden on the shoulders of our teachers, because I think a lot of times teachers end up being parents to some folks as well, to some of our children. So we appreciate your dedication to our children, and I think we end up kind of squelching some of our children's dreams because they don't think they can accomplish these things, and sometimes it's kind of just a fear of maybe science or something like that. So I encourage you to encourage your kids in areas of math, science, and engineering, and then because if they like them, they're more apt to be good at them, and then of course at NASA we have, it's kind of like Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory. You know, we just bring people in with great ideas and that are dreamers, and say like, we got to figure out a way to get to Mars. Can you help us? And when you tell a bright young engineer or scientist that, it's like, you know, where do I sit and where do I sign up, you know? So I'd encourage you to have them explore those areas of our education system.
Here. Over here. Hello, Mr. Mayor. I'm David. this is my compadre, Jeremy. I'm just curious, in reading your tweets and some of the tweets from the other astronauts and also reading the Fragile Oasis blog, do you think that sometimes you're starting to think of yourself as someone who lives and works in space and just happens to be down here for the duration until you get back up again?
Yeah, that's a good question. And, you know, before this mission, I'd flown on the space shuttle. I was gone for 15 days. So I'd been an astronaut for like 12 years and had flown in space for 15 days. So I hardly felt experienced in space. And so, yes, now I do. I do feel like I want to get back there because I think there are things that I wanted to do in the areas of science. We had over 130 experiments going on board when we were there, and I wanted to be more actively involved in the science. And I felt like I kind of got shortchanged a little bit there, and I want to go back and I want to do more. I do feel like, although I could not wait to get back to the planet as well. And just like I mentioned earlier, I thought, man, this place is a wonderful, wonderful place. And kids ask me, what's your favorite planet? And I say, Earth, because it is really just a crazy, beautiful place. And I'm not kidding when I thought to myself, man, if I had grown up somewhere else, I'd want to go to that blue planet. And so I do feel like there's more work to be done up there. And I want to go back. But it doesn't take you long to figure out that we really don't belong there, you know? And a lot of things break and things don't act quite right, and especially when you're outside going through these temperature changes, you know, mechanical things that function outside are going through these real wide temperature swings. And so things don't act like they do on Earth, you know? And so things are a little bit more complex and a little more confusing, I definitely feel that way, that I'm just sort of living here now, living my life, passing the torch to others coming behind me, but also if they have an empty space in line to get back in line, I'll raise my hand as well. So, okay, right here.
I just was sort of like, oh, yay, that's me, because I am in fifth grade. I love math, science, engineering. I like to build stuff. So that is pretty much me, and I'm also very good at math. Being one of the gifted and talented, I go to CTY, Futura, all those other gifted and talented programs, and it's just, I'm like, woohoo, that's me, I might be an astronaut someday.
Awesome. Do you have a card?
It's a sudden woohoo.
That's really great. What is your name?
Quinn.
That's perfect. It's exactly what we want you to say. And you know, there's probably sometimes when you're at school or amongst your friends, sometimes it's not cool, you know, to say like, hey, I want to study math or I want to study science or whatever it might be. But when you get in an environment, and if you're a young dreamer like you, my encouragement to you is get around other dreamers, and we'll leave a desk open for you at NASA, and we sure could use you. Come down there to work with us. Okay.
Great talking to you, Colonel.
You
mentioned briefly before, but what was the different perception versus the reality of your EVAs? And if you could possibly touch on the difference between the swimming pool in Houston and where you trained and the actual EVAs you did on the space station.
Absolutely. Well, this is sort of a replica of the suit that we wear outside. And In actuality, it weighs about 350 pounds. So in space, of course, it doesn't weigh anything, you know. But again, it has a pretty good amount of mass. And then I put my body inside of there, and now we're like more than 350 pounds. and so you have to be careful the way that you move. And the way that you break yourself, you know, if you start moving, you have to remember that F really does still equal MA in space. And so if you push off with a pretty good force, it's going to take you catching yourself with the same amount of force in the opposite direction to stop yourself. And so the biggest difference probably is it's way easier to wear this suit and go out on a spacewalk than it is to operate in the pool. In the pool, you still have the weight of the suit, you have viscosity in the water, and the pressure of the suit is about the same. It's about 4 pounds differential pressure, and so moving your hands, opening, close, is sort of an isometric maneuver each time you do that, because if you just sort of relax in the suit, you're in kind of this configuration. So if you want to bring your arms in, it's kind of like, you know, like doing a little solo flex thing, you know, and closing your hands as well. And so actually, surprisingly, the most, it's not surprising to me now, but the most tired part of your body are your hands, like your grip muscles and your forearms when you get out of the pool. And because you're just, you know, it's like taking one of those exercise band things, you know, and doing that for about 6 hours, you know, and your hands ready to fall off, you know. So the biggest difference, you have the viscosity in the water. You still have 1G in the pool, even though you're sort of neutrally buoyant. You turn upside down on your head, you still have that G that's kind of pulling you toward the bottom of the pool, and so you still feel that when you're upside down. And to move yourself in the pool, you kind of have to, you know, muscle your way around to kind of change positions and everything, because you are fighting that, the way your buoyancy. If you need to turn upside down to work on some area, it takes a little bit to overcome that buoyancy of your legs, you know, of your upper body, and kind of shift it to your lower body, so you have to kind of move around in the suit and control it that way. Now you get the space, and it's so much easier. And in the pool, it's like a 6 hour slugfest, you know, and you just feel like you've been in a boxing ring for 6 hours, you know. And then in space, it's like all it takes is just fingertip control and to turn your body and just to hold yourself with just your fingertips. And that's hard to do when you look down and there's no pool bottom anymore, you know. There's just that big blue planet down there, you know. And past that is nothing, you know. And so, you know, your initial instincts, I never got the feeling of falling, but some people get that, especially on a concave surface. But but I had this tendency to just hold on really tight, you know, and that really works against you in space, because you really over control in space and just really just take, it's more like an art, like a dance when you're outside. You just kind of move around with your fingertips and kind of control your body, just kind of turning yourself with the tips of your fingers. Biggest differences, so much easier in space. Here. Okay. Are you tweeting over there, Stephanie?
Is this working? It is. It? You sure? Okay. Hi, I'm Kate, Space Kate. I'm brave enough to tell you that I want to go to space, and that's my dream.
Awesome.
I've given myself 10 years to do it. I'm wondering, with the end of the shuttle program and the kind of hope that commercial space, private companies, going to fill that gap for you, how would you and your astronaut colleagues feel about traveling on, say, a SpaceX or orbital private vehicle into space? Would you be happy to do that, or would you wait until someone else has done it first?
I would be happy to do it. I think just maybe because of my background, I was just so excited to fly in the Soyuz. I thought, like, man, I want to experience that, you know. And coming from a test pilot background, I thought, you know, I'd be the first one to. And in fact, we went out to SpaceX before we went on our journey. It was the October prior, so it had been October 2009. Shannon and Tracy and I went to SpaceX, and we actually met with Elon Musk, the CEO, and we watched them build, because we were supposed to capture that first capsule that came up that we haven't done yet. But and I told Elon Musk, is that, you know, when you're getting ready to stick like people inside of this thing, I'd like to go, you know. And so I would love to do that. I would love to do that. And that's, would you go?
Yeah.
Would you? Okay. Yeah. Very good. Yeah, that's awesome. You're on. And so, it's actually very exciting. And I think we're in kind of a lull right now. We're sort of stunned, I think. You know, I mean, I grew up with the space shuttle program as well. And so we're all kind of like, wow, you know, where do we go next? And I think it's sort of like the gap, now I was just a kid, but the gap between when we retired, or we decided not to go back to the moon anymore, we sort of retired the last three vehicles that we had of the Saturn V, and that time during the 70s where we thought, you know, one day we're going to have a space station. It was just sort of like some fancy drawings on paper, And one day we're going to have a space shuttle that's going to build this space station. We're like, yeah, right, you know. And oh, by the way, we're going to fly and join up with the Russians. We're going to use one of these Apollo, we're going to have Apollo Soyuz, and we're going to have Skylab. And at that time, it was a real pretty heavy transition period. And actually, I think that period being even more challenging than what we're in, right, just entering in right now, I think, because we still have the space station, now using the space station as our next step to, because going out deeper and further into our solar system, I think it's going to take us building something in space. And now we've proven engineering wise that we can take pieces, we can take them to space that had never seen each other before, and we can take them to space and put them together, and they actually fit. You know, when you think about that, it's like, wow, what kind of marvel in engineering design when you can take a piece of hardware to space that was built 10 years after the part that you're going to attach it to. It's never mated before on Earth, and you have this, you know, multi-million-dollar piece of hardware, and it's like, when you hook it on there, you hope it fits, right? And so now we've proven that we can do that. So I think we're going to see the space station not only replicating our journey to Mars or another planetary body, somewhere else more exciting, I don't know. And then we couple that with now the knowledge that we've gained in putting these pieces together. Maybe we can build a rocket to take us, you know, deeper into the solar system, and we can just sort of have it connected with the space station, and maybe dock it with another capsule or something, and then undock from the space station, light a rocket, and go somewhere. You know, so, and it, right, you know, we don't think you're crazy at NASA, but you mentioned that to people, it's like, you're crazy. You know, I mean, it's like, we can't get there from here, kind of thing. But I'm here to tell you that we're working on those programs, and I think within 10 years we'll be there. You know, I think we'll be there in less than 10 years, especially with the commercial vehicles coming up online. And I think it's in our best interest to energize our commercial base as well. We're not afraid of it at NASA, and I think it's going to be a cooperative effort, not only globally, but with our industry, our education, our universities in the country, because that's where all the fresh ideas are coming from, you know. And it's like, hey, you guys, I know we've been to the moon before. We can do it again. We can go further. And so I think it's very, very exciting. And I think in 10 years we're going to see this happening. So thank you, Kate. And we'll keep a desk open for you as well.
Colonel, thank you for your service, and for obviously putting your body through some more stress than maybe anticipated.
Absolutely.
I've gotten my poor vision just through staring at a computer screen for a long time. Okay. So Alex Howard, at Digifile on Twitter, enjoyed following you a great deal and sharing your extraordinary pictures. You know, your ability to share with the world what you're seeing at a place that very few humans have ever been is quite welcome. It was extraordinary to see you start talking back, too. And so I have to take one question from someone on Twitter. I said I'd do that if I got the mic. And it's a good one, right? What does, something only you can, or a few others can say, what does space sound like? What does it smell like? There are some unconfirmed reports that the space station smells a bit like a locker room, except worse. And
I think those are actually my words.
Yep. And then the follow-up, what has this kind of reciprocal communication between you and the public, this global conversation you're participating in, taught you about the way that humanity's thinking and dreaming about space? What role do these technology platforms play in things like citizen science and bringing the public into NASA's mission?
Yeah. Man, how much time we have? Gosh, it's just, oh, gosh. What do we start with? The smell. Okay. You know, your sense of smell actually, and your sense of taste, kind of follows right along with it. It kind of gets dulled in space, and aboard the space station. I remember we first docked, we actually moved our Soyuz a couple, like just a few days after we docked. We moved to another location, but we docked originally at the aft end of the station, right at the service module, which is the Russian segment. In the Russian segment, it's one of the oldest, well, the oldest habitable module on the space station. It's been up there for 10 years or more, actually more than 10 years, because it was there before we actually put humans aboard. And you guys, your experts can probably tell me the exact date so that it was launched. But when we opened that hatch, it actually, to me, coming out of the Soyuz, now we had lived for 2 days in the Soyuz as well, three bodies inside this little tiny Soyuz. And so when we opened the hatch, it smelled much different. I don't know what we smelled like, but I know that that Russian service module smelled like the way I thought about it was like a wine cellar, you know, kind of like a, not musty, but like a, kind of like a damp, maybe a little bit, little musty kind of smell to it, I think, you know, not overpowering or anything, but that's pretty much what it smelled like. And then in the U.S. segment, it smells very sterile inside the space station. It smells like you take the, and probably smells worse than that, but your senses get dulled. I think maybe that your senses go into hibernation or something. But what it smelled like to me was, if you sort of smell that fan of the back of your computer, if you guys have a laptop, you smell that kind of like hot machinery working, you know? It's sort of like the back of an old TV or something like that. It sort of smells like that inside, very kind of sterile, like it's equipment operating, you know? Not a disconcerting smell or anything, or not anything that's, again, that's overpowering or anything. But now, smelling space, I had heard it described when I first went up on the space shuttle. I did my first spacewalk, and I came back inside. I was with Scott Peresinski, and we took our helmets off. We just come back inside. He goes, "Quick, smell your suit," you know. So he's like, you know, the suit, and he can smell space, like sort of embedded in the fibers of your suit. And so, and I'd heard it described as like burnt cookies, you know, and that kind of smell. It's sort of like a, it's like, for me, it smelled like if you lit a match and then blew it out, and then, you know, you let the kind of the wisp of smoke go off, and then you kind of smell that, the end of a match, kind of that burnt smell. That's what it smells like, what outer space smells like. And so it does have sort of a burned sense to it, you know. And actually, it doesn't take only a few minutes. It takes several weeks, actually, for that to kind of dissipate out of your suit. So I went by a couple days later and smelled my suit again, and it still smelled like that, you know. So and then when you have a vehicle dock, because the area where we dock these vehicles, whether it's a resupply unmanned ship or a shuttle, there's a section in there that's actually at vacuum. And so when it docks, then that section is pressurized. And when you open that hatch, you're actually smelling a little bit of the residue of space as well. And you smell that same smell when the new vehicle docks as well. So, and what was the other part? There are several parts to the question.
Right. The larger question is, how is the reciprocal communication changing? Because at first you were just broadcasting out your vision, and you started listening.
Yes, and I apologize for that. I was actually told, and I was actually listening, but it was really hard to get online. Well, I don't want to say hard to get online. We operated, when we get on the internet on the space station, we had to have Ku band coverage, which is a kind of a broadband coverage, which we don't always have. And sometimes we'd have like little chunks of it. Sometimes we get it in like 5 minute chunks, 10 minute chunks. Sometimes you get like a 30 or 40 minute Ku pass. And that's the only time that you can get on the internet or get on there to tweet something. So a lot of times what I would do is I'd get my tweet ready, I'd get my picture ready, and I'd have everything. So I'd just have to do a cut and paste, you know. And I'd wait for that Ku pass, and normally it has to be at a time when you're either not sleeping or not working, and so you wait for that Ku pass, and then I'd get online and, you know, paste and then send, and by the time I could the upload would happen and it would send it out. I'd get a confirmation it was gone. I'd maybe only have a few minutes left, so I didn't have enough time to read the comments that were coming back. And so I asked NASA, and NASA was very good about this. They actually were able to, in email form, they took some of the comments that were coming back and emailing them to me so I could see the discussion that was spinning off. And I never really got a chance to get back to you guys until I got back to the planet. And now it's actually kind of fun to actually write back. I'm meeting new friends and now sort of living it through your guys' eyes now, what can happen now when we get just an incredible picture or some sort of experience from space, and reliving that again with you. And so it's really, it opens up a kind of a new dimension to the tweeting thing. And so actually I'm kind of having fun with it today. I actually sent a tweet this morning without a picture attached to it. So I went to Walter Reed and said, "Hey guys, I'm at Walter Reed and see you this afternoon." And then did anybody laugh when I sent that? I sent a tweet out with me. I had my BlackBerry in that suit before I came. And I thought, you know, I got to send a kind of a cool picture. That was on the pool deck, by the way. Because while we were in training, that, you know, we always, you know, we're trying to catch up on email and everything between classes. And so, you know, the life of an astronaut's kind of like this, you know. And then you do something real dynamic, and then you're back like this on your BlackBerry or your little device, you know. And so they would give me a hard time. So I said, you know, I ought to just clip this BlackBerry. I have another picture, and maybe I'll tweet it this afternoon. I actually had the BlackBerry clipped to the side of my spacesuit, like I was going in the pool with it, you know. So I thought that would be a fun one to send out for the tweet. That was taken a couple years ago while I was going through training, but I'm glad you guys laughed because I didn't want to, you know, the naysayers would all, you know, I got responses back to say, see, I knew they staged everything, you know, so it all happens in the desert in Nevada somewhere. So, anyway, and there was another part of that question I think that I might have missed, but or you're tweeting right now, so don't bother.
See what everyone's reactions to that were.
yeah, okay. And so, actually, it's a lot of fun now. And now I can't really keep up. I'm actually doing a little bit better on my Twitter than I am my email. So, other questions?
Doug, actually, we've reached the end of our time. Unfortunately, we've had an amazing amount of questions, and maybe you can stick around after and answer a few more if you're willing. Thank you, everyone who came out today to join us for the NASA Tweetup. For those of you watching online, if you are interested in coming to a NASA Tweetup, you should follow us at NASA Tweetup, and you can find all of NASA's social media accounts at nasa.gov/connect, and nasa.gov/tweetup is where you register for Tweetup events. So thank you for joining us. You can find us on the hashtag NASA Tweetup, and have a great afternoon.
Thank you guys.